Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight to honor four remarkable leaders in their fields. And to enjoy the company of an extraordinary audience, you are among some 800 individuals from more than 50 countries, former heads of state and government, senior government officials, ambassadors, global business leaders, media, civil society, and one of the finest country western performers of our times. Hey, Toby, great to see you with your pal, General Jones. Each year you've asked for more time to network with each other, so this year we built in this extra time at the beginning of the evening so you could enjoy your first course and greet your dinner companions. So now that we have your full attention, please welcome to the stage the Atlantic Council Chairman, Governor John Huntsman.
Thank you, Fred. With that kind of power over the crowd, Fred, I wish I'd had you 4 years ago in the Iowa caucus. The turnout would have been a whole lot different. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor to welcome you here to the Atlantic Council's 2015 Distinguished Leadership Awards Dinner. It's an honor to welcome you here to celebrate four individuals who exemplify the leadership, the vision, the character that today's demands and times require. Yet even as we celebrate these individual leaders, the Atlantic Council's mission is to advance a far more ambitious form of leadership that is equal to the challenges of the times. We recognize that the United States, Europe, and our global friends and allies face one of the most volatile international environments in recent memory. While we gathered on this very stage last year, as Ruslan is saying so passionately about the Maidan, we were facing Russia's brutal aggression in Ukraine and its illegal annexation of Crimea. Today, 12 months later, the crisis in Ukraine continues, endangering Europe and the global system, even while new challenges proliferate. We see an alarming spread of extremist factions and violence across the Middle East and Africa. We are wrestling with the pitfalls and possibilities of an Iranian nuclear deal and rising sectarian tensions. We're coming to terms with China's growing influence, not only in its immediate region, but indeed around the globe. There is also much to celebrate around the world, lest we forget. America's energy revolution and economic strength, promising advances in technology, a global reduction of poverty and rising middle class, the possibility of new trade agreements, and 2016 elections that could galvanize a national conversation about America's role in the world. How cool would that be? The Atlantic Council is propelled by the belief that we currently find ourselves at a defining moment in history, where policy choices will have enormous consequences for decades to come, not unlike 1815, 1919, 1945, 1989. The United States must pull together with its like-minded global friends to shape the future and confront the reality that less benevolent actors or chaos will fill the void if we don't do so. Witness Ukraine, witness Syria. That will take a level of strategic thinking and action that has thus far escaped us. Now, during the Cold War, our strategy was pretty clear. Containing the Soviet Union and its brand in communism, our work now at the Atlantic Council is focused on advancing the strategies and policies required for this new, more complex world, so that we can achieve the best and avoid the worst. The Council is extremely fortunate and honored that its mission is guided by some of the greatest strategic minds in America's recent history. In fact, two of my predecessors as Atlantic Council Chairman are with us here tonight, General Brent Scowcroft and General Jim Jones. We wouldn't be here tonight if it had not been for General Scowcroft's direction and vision for the renewal of the Council's mission after the Cold War.
He again served as interim chairman directly prior to me in ensuring that the council kept up the incredible momentum it had gained under Secretary Chuck Hagel's leadership. Brent, it's an honor to follow in your footsteps as chairman of this remarkable organization. General Jones presided over the Atlanta Council at a time when it was poised to do great things but needed strong, innovative leadership to get to the next level and expand its global mission. Thanks to the groundwork that he laid and the energy he injected during his chairmanship, we now have 10 programs and centers. 10 programs and centers, ladies and gentlemen, which work on nearly every corner of the world. And though he couldn't be here tonight, I'm delighted to announce that Chuck Hagel will rejoin the council as a distinguished statesman and on the International Advisory Board. Of course, General Scowcroft, General Jones, and Secretary Hagel didn't do it alone. We as chairman have had the great fortune to work shoulder to shoulder with President and CEO of the Atlanta Council, Fred Kemp. Now, Fred, as you know, operates with a level of energy and focus that has propelled this organization forward in ways that most would have deemed absolutely impossible. Fred and I have even managed to become somewhat civil toward one another, despite having attended rival high schools in Salt Lake City, Utah. Fred, thank you for your leadership, for working tirelessly to advance the council's mission, and for convening this remarkable community here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Fred Kemp.
All I can say, Governor, is go Skyline Eagles. He was from the Highland Rams, and you probably have never heard of them. But thank you, Governor. Your vision is compelling. Your leadership is inspirational. For the good of the country, I wish your name were among the many candidates for president. For the good of the Atlantic Council, I'm relieved it is not. In this intimate gathering, I want to share a secret with you. Governor Huntsman spends a lot of time at the Atlantic Council. He contributes enormous time and effort, and he's putting a hugely important mark on the organization. On behalf of everyone on the Atlantic Council staff, thank you for your leadership, but also thank you for your personal attention to each and every staff member you ever encounter at the Atlantic Council. And thanks to Mary Kay for all she does as an Atlantic Council ambassador as well, an extraordinary ambassador. Ladies and gentlemen, please, as Governor Huntsman said, give it up for our chairman, Mary Kay Huntsman, with a warm round of applause. We are also joined this evening by three former heads of state and government, former President of Poland, Alexander Kwasniewski, former Prime Minister of Pakistan, Shaukat Aziz, former Prime Minister of Sweden, Carl Bildt. Thank you for being here, gentlemen. I'm also delighted that six of our previous honorees are with us. I'd ask you, as I name you, to stand for the and then for the audience to hold its applause as I read your names. Airbus Group CEO Tom Enders, Blackstone Group Chairman and CEO Steven Schwartzman, former Commander of Allied Command Transformation General Stefan Abrial, former NATO Secretary General Lord Robertson of Port Ellen, two-time National Security Advisor General Brent Scowcroft, former National Security Advisor and NATO Supreme Allied Commander General Jim Jones, and Atlantic Council Freedom Award recipient, President Alexander Kwasniewski. Please join me in saluting these gentlemen. I would also like to have the women and men of our International Advisory Board and Council Board of Directors stand at this moment. The Atlantic Council is where it is today because of you. You are the Atlantic Council. You help us in so many respects. Please, International Advisory Board members and board members of the Atlantic Council, please rise so we can applaud you. Thank you for making my job so much easier. And that was my favorite part of the introductions and asking people to stand for your applause. All program and center directors and all staff members of the Atlantic Council are here. Please rise. There is no more resourceful, creative, hardworking, or committed team in Washington or perhaps anywhere else. Please all stand so we can applaud you. Welcome all, anyone who's not stood so far, no, I'm just joking. welcome also to the Council's first class of Millennium Fellows, a group of 21 extraordinary leaders, young leaders, picked from 800 candidates, young business, government, civil society leaders from across 5 continents, all at the cutting edge of their fields. Thank you for being here, and thank you also for Robert Abernathy from our board for being chair of this effort and inspiring it. And finally, I want to welcome Elliot Ackerman, the author of one of 2 books in your gift bag, a decorated veteran. Elliot Ackerman writes compellingly about a young orphan fighting against coalition forces in Afghanistan. The New York Times Review said in writing its review of the book, quote, Elliot has done something brave as a writer and even braver as a soldier. He has touched for real the culture and soul of his enemy, unquote. Elliot, where are you? Please stand. Thank you for your story and for your service. The second book in your gift bags is a remarkable biography of a remarkable man, General Brent Scowcroft, without whom I'm not sure any of you or the Atlantic Council itself, and certainly not me, would be here this evening. The Strategist by Bartholomew Sparrow. Take your gift bags home and read it and learn. As you can see by the community we've gathered here tonight, the Council has never been in a position to act on its mission of working together to secure the future. But as Governor Huntsman said, the mission has perhaps never been in greater jeopardy. The United States and its full range of allies and partners have more ability to shape the future than we currently exercise. And that's what the Atlantic Council is about. How do we maximize the ability that we have to shape the future? We are driven by a conviction that with a well-developed and consistently implemented global strategy with our allies, defining America's role in the world for a new generation, we can ensure that peace, prosperity, and freedom, not violence, disorder, and repression, define the future. We'll never achieve that without the right leadership, and that's what this dinner is about. To shine a spotlight on leaders that we respect and want to honor, and to try to inspire others through their example. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani said in Washington last month, when he came to meet President Obama and speak to a joint session of Congress, quote, leadership is about sacrifice. Leadership is not about privilege. So perhaps that's the theme for this evening, the vigorous application of principled leadership in the face of the historic challenge. Our awardees tonight represent 4 pillars of global leadership: political, business, military, and artistic. We honor President Ashraf Ghani of Afghanistan for his selfless courage, his exceptional vision, and his personal integrity at a moment of historic significance for his country and the region and the Islamic world. We salute Supreme Allied Commander Europe, General Philip Breedlove, for a career of remarkable service, but tonight in particular, for his steadfast leadership of our allied troops during the most significant change in NATO's defense posture and the most serious threat to European order since the end of the Cold War. We honor Lockheed Martin Chairman, President and CEO Marillyn Hewson, one of the globe's most respected business executives, for her remarkable record of personal leadership and bottom line results. Running the world's largest defense contractor with 113,000 employees and navigating a moment of unique complexity and global uncertainty with strong business leadership and constant humanity. We celebrate country music legend Toby Keith, whose musical hits have sold more than 40 million albums worldwide, while exercising his special brand of patriotism both through his music, and then the count on this is a little bit uncertain. Some say he's had 213 performances for U.S. and allied soldiers around the world, but those who have higher security clearances tell me it's actually 237. And that just underscores that he goes to places that the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders do not. He also said something quite important about leadership in one of the lyrics to his songs. And let me quote, "I ain't as good as I once was, but I am as good once as I ever was." It has nothing really to do with leadership, but I wanted to get that in. So welcome. Thank you for being with us tonight. Now it is my privilege to welcome another remarkable leader to introduce our first honoree tonight. Jim McNerney, Boeing Chairman and CEO, understands how to combine strategic thinking with a dogged focus on results and a keen sense of history. In a recent interview, he said, and I quote, "Our company produced 91,000 airplanes during World War II. Democracy won that war and has enabled us to participate in the next 50 years. That's exciting and motivates the hell out of us every day." Ladies and gentlemen, Jim McNerney.
Thank you, Fred, and my thanks to the Atlanta Council for the opportunity to be here tonight, and for your leadership and engagement on global issues that are shaping this complex new century. Now, some people might consider it peculiar for the chairman of one big old aerospace defense company to travel halfway across the country to say nice things about the leader of one of its toughest competitors. The psychiatrists here, and there must be at least a couple out there, might even call it cognitive dissonance, but not really, not really. We have much in common. Our two companies trace their humble roots back for about a century, with the first airplanes built in a rented church and garage almost 103 years ago in Lockheed Martin's case, and in a boathouse about 99 years ago in the case of Boeing. Our traditions spring from a handful of pioneers who risked their fortunes, reputations, and even their lives. They did so to build the industry that won a world war and then a cold war and turned the airplane into an instrument of global travel and commerce. Today, we are both fortunate to be pillars of a U.S. aerospace and defense sector that continues to be a national strategic asset for our country to this very day. Which brings me to one of our industry's most admired leaders, tonight's honoree, Marillyn Hewson. Since taking the helm at Lockheed roughly 2.5 years ago, Marillyn has provided a guiding light and firm hand to the world's largest defense company. The story goes that when Marillyn was a young girl, her mom would send her to the grocery store with instructions to buy, about $7 worth of items. The catch was she only gave Marillyn $5 to spend. Pretty good early training for dealing with sequestration, I would think. From Boeing's perspective, Marillyn has turned an always worthy business adversary in Lockheed Martin into an even more formidable competitor, in many cases, though, a valued partner as well. In fact, Boeing and Lockheed are taking this compete and collaborate approach to a whole new level with our joint proposal to build the next long-range strike bomber for the U.S. Air Force. Marillyn has been an articulate and dogged advocate for public policies and levels of funding that will keep the United States second to none in the stars, in the skies, and on the battlefield, even during an era of gridlock and budget uncertainty here in D.C. In all, it would be very difficult to imagine a more fitting recipient of this year's Distinguished Business Leadership Award than Marillyn Hewson. And now I am deeply honored to present Marillyn with the 2015 Distinguished Business Leadership Award.
Wonderful introduction. I appreciate it. You know, over the years, our companies have shown that we share many of the same values, and it's truly an honor for me tonight to be introduced by a respected competitor, a strong partner, and a good friend. So thank you again, Jim. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and members of the Atlantic Council. I'd like to begin first by thanking Governor Huntsman and the Atlantic Council for this prestigious award. I also want to congratulate my fellow honorees. It's truly a privilege to share this stage with such impressive leaders. Clearly, this prestigious award is a tribute to the accomplishments of the 112,000 men and women of Lockheed Martin and their commitment to our over 100-year legacy of innovation and exceptional service to our customers. So I humbly accept this award on their behalf. It's especially rewarding for us to receive this recognition from the Atlantic Council. There are few organizations that have done more to meet the global challenges of our time. The Atlantic Council has become an essential forum for the 21st century issues, such as cyber statecraft or Middle East peace, to the future of energy markets, and to transatlantic trade and security. For decades, the Council has held fast to its founding mission to bring people together to act in common purposes in order to shape a better future. You are the champions of collaboration and partnership beyond geopolitical boundaries. The spirit of working together across borders is one that resonates with Lockheed Martin. It's a key part of our history, and it's the foundation of our success. In the 1950s, for example, the head of our Skunk Works Advanced Research Center, Kelly Johnson, wanted to know what pilots needed and how we could serve them better. The pilots he talked to said they wanted more speed and they wanted more altitude. This led to the F-104 Starfighter, the most advanced warplane of its age. In fact, it was sometimes called the missile with a man in it. West Germany, as a new NATO member, was anxious to have this elite aircraft. However, as Kelly later relayed, 10 years after World War II, German pilots had no modern jet experience, especially supersonic. So Lockheed launched specialized training programs and sent experts to teach West German engineers how to translate Lockheed Martin plans, technical orders, and unfamiliar parts into true working fighters. The collaboration between the German government and Lockheed was so successful that other nations quickly followed suit, purchasing licensing rights for the aircraft over the ensuing decades. And by 1980, when the last starfighter was manufactured, some 14 countries, including Canada, Japan, Italy, Turkey, and Taiwan, had operated F-104s, using them in a multitude of roles, from interceptors and ground attack aircraft to reconnaissance jets. This is just one story in our long history that demonstrates the common good that comes from working together. And it's a model of the collaboration that has made us successful over the years. The fact is that it's the innovation that comes from collaboration that is so critical to addressing the dynamic challenges that we collectively face today. To ensure that we maintain our competitive advantage on the global stage, together, we must nurture and advance our spirit of innovation and collaboration. That requires two things: investment in our resources and development of our future innovators. Let me talk to you first about the resources we need to secure the future. As you all know, the Transatlantic Alliance faces unprecedented threats on multiple borders, from violent extremism to violations of national sovereignty. Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Marty Dempsey, summarized the current situation well in his recent testimony to the Senate Armed Services Committee. He said that the global security environment is as uncertain as he's ever seen it in his 40 years of service. I couldn't agree more. To address these unprecedented challenges, it requires that our governments invest in a strong national defense. So I was encouraged that the NATO leaders once again reaffirmed their commitment to spending 2% of GDP on defense at their last year's Wales summit. Here in the U.S., budget uncertainty, driven by sequestration, continues to put America's leadership at risk. As long as sequestration is on the table, we are undermining our ability to protect America's sovereignty and defend our interests around the world, not just for today, but for tomorrow as well. To be clear, since 2011, when the Budget Control Act was enacted, the threats to our nation and to the Transatlantic Alliance have grown while we continue to debate fiscal priorities. However, while we debate, current and potential adversaries are investing in asymmetric and fifth generation technologies that will enable them to challenge our values and our interests. As a nation, we must work together to put sequestration behind us. We must find a better solution that addresses our fiscal challenges and that aligns our defense spending with our national security strategy. And as an industry, we must do our part in preparing our nation for the future threats that we will face. Although research and development spending as a percentage of U.S. defense budget has declined since 2012, Lockheed Martin has increased our R&D investment for three consecutive years to more than $750 million. And industry-wide, major U.S. defense firms spent more than $4.3 billion on R&D in 2014 alone. However, maintaining our competitive advantage requires more than the investment of resources. It demands that we invest in our future innovators, people like Kelly Johnson, who have the right expertise to solve the increasingly difficult technological problems of the modern world. And this, too, is a challenge for each of us in this room, because there simply aren't enough students graduating in science, technology, engineering, and math, or the STEM fields, to meet the increasing demand. We need to break down barriers to get the best talent from around the world working on the toughest challenges. Working together, we can inspire the next generation to pursue STEM by showing them how exciting and rewarding these jobs can be. That's one of the reasons I'm so proud that Lockheed Martin invests about half of our annual philanthropy budget into STEM programs here in the U.S. and around the world. And while financial support is invaluable, the STEM need is much greater than just making donations. We know that students respond better to role models who can inspire and mentor them in STEM fields. That's why we create opportunities for our engineers to work with students, to tell them their stories and life experiences, and inspire them to become STEM innovators. These investments can make a huge difference. For example, years ago, a Lockheed Martin employee brought her daughter to a Young Minds at Work Day. The little girl had the chance to hear NASA astronaut Bruce McCandless speak, and as a result, she decided she wanted to work in the aerospace industry when she grew up. Well, a few years later, that same young woman went off to college. And while there, she heard a Lockheed Martin engineer talk about the Orion space program and the NASA's mission to Mars. She quickly decided that Lockheed Martin was the right company for her. Today, Heather McKay is a Lockheed Martin Orion propulsion engineer and a STEM ambassador committed to inspiring the next generation of young people to pursue STEM careers. Heather is just one example of how each of us in this room can influence and inspire the next generation of future innovators. The challenges I've discussed tonight will only grow in the years ahead. More threats to global security, more need for international collaboration and innovation, and more demand for technical expertise. As we navigate these challenges and seize the opportunities they present, together, we will shape a shared future, a better future. Our collective prosperity on both sides of the Atlantic has been and continues to be propelled by sharing ideas and technology. Together, we can leverage the spirit of partnership to foster security, innovation, and prosperity here and abroad. Thank you again to the Atlantic Council for this prestigious honor.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the stage Atlantic Council President and CEO, Mr. Fred Kemp.
Marillyn Hewson, thank you for that important message. I think everyone in the audience knows that you just said something we all had to listen to. What really sets apart the Atlantic Council and what sets apart so many people in this audience is that we have a mission and we have a purpose, and you address that. Sequestration, we're better than that. Science and technology, the message is brilliant. Thank you so much. Let me go to our next awardee. The Atlantic Council chose Ashraf Ghani to receive its highest honor this year for two compelling reasons. His remarkable quality as an individual and the enormity of the challenge that he confronts. President Ghani's daughter, Mariam Ghani, will talk about her father in Afghanistan in a moment. But before she does so, it's my pleasure to announce a new Atlantic Council initiative, Afghanistan Rising, that we hope will help President Ghani and his national unity government tackle this historic challenge. Our initiative, we hope, will help sustain American and international engagement in Afghanistan at exactly the moment that the drawdown of forces will tempt our nations to turn their attention elsewhere, and we've seen the consequences of that before. To help us in that task, it's my further pleasure to announce the creation of the Council's new Zalmay Khalilzad Chair on Afghanistan, made possible by a generous gift from Atlantic Council Board Director and former U.S. Ambassador to Afghanistan, Zalmay Khalilzad. Zal was supposed to give the comments I'm giving right now, and he wanted to be here tonight, but delayed flights to and from Erbil in the Kurdish Republic of Iraq ahead of President Barzani's trip here next week intervened, and so he gives you all his apologies for not being here. This Khalilzad Chair will lead the Afghanistan Rising Initiative to to advance strategies, policies, and concrete projects, working closely with our friends and allies in Afghanistan to help ensure that we do not miss this historic moment. We probably have never had a better opportunity in Afghanistan than now, and there's probably no greater temptation to walk away than at this moment. So we are proud also this evening to announce the first occupant of the Khalilzad chair. We move fast at the Atlantic Council. The first Khalilzad chair is James Cunningham, who recently completed his service as ambassador to Afghanistan. Jim, through his postings at the United Nations, NATO, Europe, and in Asia, will bring a wealth of experience of working Afghanistan's most important partners and is uniquely positioned to galvanize this action with a larger regional purpose and global purpose behind it. Where are you, Jim? Could you please rise so we can applaud you? Thank you so much. It's terrific to have you on board, and it's terrific that Ambassador Khalilzad has given us this opportunity. It is President Ghani's election and the inauguration of Afghanistan's unity government that presents this critical opportunity for Afghanistan, its region, and the West. President Ghani, as you know, was here in about a month ago, seeing the President, speaking to Congress. And he said to me, "Fred, of course I'm going to come back." He was an International Advisory Board member. We've known him here for years. And I said to him, "You know, you've got some issues to take care of in your country and the region. And much as I'd like you to come back and honor your friendship to the Atlantic Council and me, I think we have to relieve you of this responsibility." So he accepted his award during an inaugural visit to Washington as president at a private reception in the company of NATO's leadership, including Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg and the entire NATO North Atlantic Council. I did make a deal with him, though, and I said, "You know, you may not be able to come, but I've read about your daughter, this very accomplished artist in New York, and perhaps you could send her." And so we're delighted to welcome President Ghani's daughter, Mariam, to represent him this evening. And in a moment, we'll share with you a video from the evening where he gave the award, when former Secretary of State Madeleine Albright presented her friend President Ghani with it. But let me now introduce Mariam to represent her father. She is accomplished in her own right, a talented artist whose work has been showcased around the world, from New York's Museum of Modern Art to the Tate Modern in London. One of her works, Afghanistan, A Lexicon, was a collaboration with her father, creating a moving illustration of Afghanistan's rich, yet often troubled history, as a series of cycles from birth to destruction to resurrection. The New York Times described Mariam as a, quote, "feminist, an archivist, and an activist, as well versed in the politics of extraordinary rendition as she is in the very Brooklyn pursuit of homemade chili passion fruit sorbet." So please welcome to the stage Mariam Ghani.
Thank you, Fred, for that lovely introduction. You know, sometimes I wonder if I will ever live that sorbet down, or live up to it, perhaps, I'm not sure. So I've been told, although I don't actually remember this myself, that when I was a very small child, my father taught me to shout "feminism and reification" at anthropology department parties. So you know who to blame for the feminism and the activism. Seriously, though, I'm delighted and honored to be here today to accept this award on behalf of my father, President Ashraf Ghani. I was raised by my parents in the tradition of public service, which I know many of you also belong to. And I know how much it means to him to to receive this award. I know he wishes he could be here himself to celebrate with all of you, as Fred said. But as you know, he has a rather demanding job. And I can't imagine anyone else doing it with such a remarkable balance of strength, skill, and grace. My father not only has an insatiable thirst for knowledge, he also has a photographic memory and an uncanny ability to synthesize information. It's kind of unfair, right, to have all of those things in one person. But it really makes him one of the best system thinkers that I know. He is unfailingly dedicated to his work, but he never loses sight of the human costs of public policies. He does notoriously have a bit of a temper, but he also has a wicked sense of humor, and somehow his jokes are all much funnier in Afghanistan than they ever were here. But, you know, anyone who knows him probably knows all of this. What you may not know is that Ashraf is part of a long tradition of Afghan intellectuals in high office. Stretching back to the early years of the 20th century, the poet-statesman Mahmud Tarzi, and the constitutional movement known as the Young Afghans, as well as their mid-century successors, the Awakened Youth, two movements that reimagined Afghan politics. Ashraf's presidency represents, among many other things, a reconnection to that tradition, and an opportunity for today's young Afghans, and I hope, particularly for young Afghan women, to reimagine Afghan politics again. We Ghanis are not programmed for failure. That's a family joke. But so far, it has actually proved to be true. My father is indeed an extraordinary leader, and on behalf of all of us who are depending on that leadership, thank you so much for recognizing it with this award. And now, please turn your attention to the screens for the video of the earlier event.
The Atlantic Council's Distinguished International Leadership Award is given annually to a global figure who has made an enduring contribution to the international community. That's a somewhat bland way of describing a doer, which is my preferred term for the gentleman we honor this evening. Like many in this room, I have known Ashraf Ghani for years. I must say that I was immediately impressed. He was a brilliant economist, a provocative thinker, and a compelling international figure. He also didn't hesitate to make his opinions known, but then again, shrinking violets don't go very far in Afghan politics. President Ghani and his unity government have already set a new tone and established a new way of doing business. He has rebuilt his country's relations with its long-standing partners, making heartfelt gestures of gratitude for the many sacrifices that have been made. He has refocused the international community on the important work that is left for us to accomplish, giving the world confidence that Afghanistan's government is committed to the rule of law and protecting the rights of its people, including Afghan women and girls. But above all, he has offered hope to the Afghan people and to the world, hope that we can turn the page and begin writing what he has called a new book of cooperation, understanding, and engagement. So let me thank the Atlantic Council for giving us the opportunity to reaffirm our solidarity with the people of Afghanistan. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure to present the Atlantic Council's Distinguished International Leadership Award to a true statesman and a very dear friend, President Ashraf Ghani.
In the name of God, the Merciful, the Compassionate, Secretary Albright, Mr. Kemp, Secretary General Stoltenberg, General Palmeiros, General Jones, many friends, I'm humbled by the words of the introduction. Atlantic Council has been a second home to me, and my friendship with Fred Kemp has been intense, multidimensional, and focused on the globe. I want to pay tribute to General Jones, who was Supreme Allied Commander of NATO, for engaging in Afghanistan. I'd also like to acknowledge my long friendship with Zar Khalilzad. We've shared a very eventful 50 years together. Our paths have always crossed, and I'm looking very much forward to your more intense engagement with Afghanistan. Afghanistan has suffered, but we are a resilient people. What people must understand about us are our two sides. One is that those who come in anger to us never leave. From Alexander down, they've made the wrong calculations, and it's been difficult. But the other side of our character, unfortunately, the first side has become our stereotype. The other is that hospitality, warmth, friendship are characteristics that really embody our values. And our request is extraordinarily simple. We just want to be able to breathe normally. What we are determined to do is not to become victims of history, not to repeat history, but to overcome it, and in the process, make new history. What I consider the test is not just peace, not just prosperity, but the highest test that we in the Muslim world, frankly, have had difficulty, succession to high office through orderly process. So what I'd like to be a catalyst for is a remarkable team of young men and women, and hopefully from among them, also the first woman president of Afghanistan. Thank you and good night.
Thank you, Mariam, and please send our thanks to your father. We look forward to working with President Ghani and the people of Afghanistan in setting the country on the best path to the future. And it's great to have Governor Huntsman back on stage so we can recognize this evening's co-chairs, without whom this dinner and so much of the Atlantic Council's current work would be possible. Please hold your applause. There are quite a few co-chairs until all have been named and have joined us on stage. Bob Abernathy, Carl Hopkins representing Denton's, Adrian Arsht, Azan Bayat, Tom Blair, Tewodros Ashanafi, Melanie Chen, Victor Chu, Richard Edelman, Tom Enders, Rafik Bisri representing Baha Hariri, Jason Koloski representing Raytheon International Inc., Marillyn Hewson, Dan Casserly representing Novartis, Jim Jones, General Jim Jones, General Stefan Abrial representing Safran USA, George Lund, William Lin III, Alexander Mirchev, Nazik Keen representing SAIC, Amit Oren, Adam Marks representing Thales USA, General Brent Scowcroft, Francis Bouchard representing Zurich Insurance Group, Kate Friedrich representing Thomson Reuters. Ladies and gentlemen, these are this evening's co-chairs. Thank each and every one of you. We couldn't do it without you. Thank you so much. What some of you in the audience probably don't realize is we aren't just assembling co-chairs. In reality, Ambassador Huntsman, Governor Huntsman, we've just organized a choir.
That's right. Aside from this being a great-looking group of very successful people who are central to the success of the Atlanta Council, they apparently have a pretty good musical aptitude. And it just so happens that this last March, a very special man celebrated a birthday. Another person who's been absolutely central, not only to the Atlanta Council, but the well-being of the modern world, Brent Scowcroft. Brent turned 90 years old this last March, and what we'd like to do is get everybody off their seats to join with this choir in a round of happy birthday to Brent. So if you'll join us on three, one, two, three. Choir dismissed, right, Fred?
Well, first of all, I just want to say, General Scowcroft, please forgive me, and please enjoy your meals, and we'll be back with you in a few minutes for the second half of the program. Stay here for 1 minute. We're going to do a photograph.